Hello? If you can begin to wrap up your discussions, find your way to your seats, we will get going here. Man, can we get the lights a little brighter? Thank you. Welcome to Ascent Bible Church. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We're entering into an interesting time of year right now for several reasons. First of all, it's the holiday season. Secondly, it is the election season. And third, even this week, is a season where the world actually celebrates and rejoices in ugliness and evil and wickedness. And that's heartbreaking, but we have to understand that people who have been misled, people who've been deceived, follow things that are not necessarily good for them in the long run. And today the message is going to be on deception and how to discern false teachers and false doctrines and false spirits. So let's open up our hearts. Let's open up our eyes and our ears to truth today as we lift up our voices, we lift up our prayers, we lift up songs to the Lord Jesus Christ and to the God of all creation. Let's pray. Lord, we come together today with hearts that sincerely desire to give you the glory that you deserve. And we confess to you, Lord, that we may not be able to do that perfectly, but that doesn't keep us from desiring to do it as well as can be done. Receive from us today, Lord, our acknowledgement of your goodness, of your greatness, our thanksgiving for your love and your mercy, even for the gift of life. The fact, Lord, that you have blessed us with a place to gather, your word to guide us, the truth to protect us. And as we take this time, we dedicate this time to you, Lord. Use it not only for your glory, but to bring us closer to that perfect worship that you desire. We thank you for being with us today. We pray your Spirit to descend upon this place and to manifest his power in our hearts. For your glory, Lord, and for our good, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Alrighty, so in Psalm 115, it says, "Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but unto thy name give glory, for thy mercy and for thy truth's sake. Wherefore should the heathen say, where is now their God? But our God is in the heavens, and he hath done whatsoever he hath pleased. Their idols are silver and gold, and the work of men's hands. They have mouths, but they speak not. Eyes have they, but they see not. They have ears, but they hear not. Noses, but they smell not. They have hands, but they handle not. Feet have they, but they walk not. Neither speak they through their throat. They that make them are like unto them, so is everyone that trusteth in them. O Israel, trust thou in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. O house of Aaron, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. Ye that fear the Lord, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. The Lord hath been mindful of us, and he will bless us. He will bless the house of Israel. He will bless the house of Aaron. He will bless them that fear the Lord, both small and great. The Lord shall increase you more and more, and your children, you and your children. Yea, are blessed of the Lord, which have made heaven and earth. The heaven, even the heavens, are the Lord's. But the earth that he given, that he has. The dead praise not the Lord, neither any that go down into silence. But we will bless the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. Praise the Lord. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a
sing a little louder. Heaven comes to fight for me. Sing a little louder. Father, we thank you for this morning, for your never-ending love for us, Lord God, for your mercy and for your grace. And Lord God, we just pray that this morning that we would recognize who you are and how you fight for us. And no matter how much we try to do on our own, Lord God, we just ask that you would give us the strength to take up our cross and follow you, Lord God. Put on your armor, Father, and then you would fight for us, Lord God. In Jesus' name, amen. There's a peace that outlasts darkness, a hope that's in the blood. There's a future grace that's mine today, that Jesus Christ has won. So I can face tomorrow, for tomorrow's in your hands, and all I need you will provide. Just like you always have. I'm fighting a battle you've already won. No matter what comes my way, I will overcome. Don't know what you're doing, but I know what you've done. Your spirit is my help. He'll fix my eyes on Jesus Christ. I'll say that it is well. Oh, I know that it is well. I'm fighting a battle you've already won. No matter what comes, my Savior, my defense. No more fear in life or death. Proclaim it, church. And I know how the story ends. We will be with you again. Death. Hallelujah.
24, 3 through 4, it says, "Who shall ascend to the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift his soul to what is false and does not swear deceitfully." So, dear Lord, I just thank you so much for this time of worship to be able to come to you and give you all the glory and honor that you deserve. And I just pray for each and every one of us right now that we just give whatever is on our hearts and whatever we're anxious about or thinking about, Lord, that we just give it to you right now and cleanse us from all our sin and all our unrighteousness, that it's pleasing to you.
Psalm 119 verse 105, the Bible says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I know we know what is a path. Path is a somewhere you walk through. If you're walking through a path and it is dark, I promise you will bump. You will fall down. But when you have the word of God in you, the word of God lightens your path. And there is no way you will swerve to the wrong way. Just like a headlamp in the car. If your headlight is on, there's no way you will swerve. And that is the word of God. If the word of God dwells in you, you will never go wrong. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, I think I've lost my way. As long as you are near, please be near me to the end. Oh, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet. For me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide. I hold me to your side, and I'll love you to the end. Oh, thy word is a lamp unto my feet.
Boy, those songs, they just fit right in the groove of this message this morning. The second song, I'm fighting a battle you've already won. We were reminded this morning during prayer that we're not living in a playground. We're living in a battleground. And the real battle is for truth. And this message is about how do you discern the difference between truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Because there are very sly forces at work that want to corrupt the truth. They want to pervert the truth. They want to water down the truth. And if you are someone who is concerned about that today, this message is for you. I'm going to cover several different aspects of discerning truth, every one of them based on Scripture. And that last song, God's Word is a light unto our path, a lamp unto our feet. And the way that you can best protect yourself against even partial truths is to know God's Word. That doesn't come from a single reading. It generally does not come through 5 minutes of quick devotion on any given day. It comes by way of serious, intentional, dedicated time, spending your time reading God's Word. And if you were to honestly take a look at how you use your time during the week, I wonder if you would be able to identify periods of time that you use for things that are not eternal, that could be rededicated to things that are eternal. When speaking of anything false, we first have to ask, why must there be absolute truth? Well, I'll answer that with another question. Who is qualified to be the arbiter, that is, the judge of right and wrong, if there is no absolute truth? Should we use your truth? Should we use my truth or somebody else's truth? In the words of Pontius Pilate in John 18:18, after Jesus told him about the truth, he asked, what is truth? And I dare say that if you were to talk about truth to people outside of the Church of Jesus, they would ask you, what is truth? You have your truth, I have my truth. As long as we're faithful to what we believe, we should be okay. Jesus warns in Matthew 24:24, there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that, if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Behold, I have told you before. In other words, be on the lookout. This is going to happen. The Apostle John advises in 1 John 4:1, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Imagine, we can actually test the spirit of whatever doctrine is being proposed to us, and we can come up with a godly evaluation of whether it's from him or not. The Apostle Peter reminds and admonishes in 2 Peter 2:1 to verse 3, but there were false prophets also among the people, That's in the past. Even as there shall be false teachers among you who privily or privately, secretly, shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. And through covetousness shall they with feigned words make merchandise of you. And in Timothy, Paul warns that there are people who will use godliness as a means to financial gain. They're called charlatans. They prey on the desire, the sincere desire in our hearts to be right with God, to get us to send them money. Cast your bread upon the water and God's going to return it 100-fold. But God establishes a way to discern. In Deuteronomy 13:1, if there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams and giveth thee a sign or a wonder, and the sign or the wonder come to pass, whereof he spake unto thee, saying, let us go after other gods, which thou hast not known, and let us serve them, thou shalt not hearken unto the words of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams. For the Lord your God proveth you to know whether ye love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. So even if a prophecy comes true, which is another test God gives in Deuteronomy of determining a false prophet, if it doesn't come true, he absolutely is false. But if the prophecy comes true and then he says, let's go after this God over here, you also know that he's a false prophet. Man's ways are corrupt and his heart perverse. And we don't need God or the Bible to tell us that if we just look around. Jesus provides a clue in Matthew 24:37. As the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. And I think we all know what Scripture says about those days. Genesis 6:5, God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Do you not see that in the wickedness that is so pervasive in our society and in the world around us? Talking about that difference between the playground and the battleground. The death, the destruction. When you're in a war, there's nothing comfortable. There's nothing quiet. There's nothing safe about the battleground. You better be watching, because your enemy is watching you and he wants to take you out of the battle. It is the very influence and effect of mankind's sin and sinfulness which makes any one person or group of persons unfit to set moral standards for all of us. Scripture reveals what it looks like when we permit that to happen in Judges 17:6 and repeated in Judges 21:25. In those days, there was no king in Israel, but every man did that which was right in his own eyes. That's my truth. You do what's right in your eyes, that's your truth. And how does that happen? The king is no longer in command in the land. And in America, that was Jesus. Remember, they weren't heathens. They were the very nation which God called to be his own and to whom he revealed himself by delivering them from Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. And does the U.S. have any less reason to honor and trust the God who has blessed us so abundantly? The Apostle Paul refers to God as the Lord, the righteous judge, in 2 Timothy 4:8. You see, we have to have someone above us, outside of us, to set the standard. because my standard will be different than your standard based on our experience, based upon our moral compass, based upon a lot of things. And people will say to you, if that's the way you want to live, live that way. But don't try to put your laws on my body. Does that sound familiar? And that's because they have a different set of standards than we do. But our standards come from the Lord. His are above and beyond. And I know I've said this before from this pulpit. What would this world be like if everyone in the world did nothing more than obey the Ten Commandments of God? Imagine. Imagine the peace. Imagine the harmony. Imagine the glory of God. But we don't do that. God is the only one qualified to define truth and righteously apply it in every instance. For this reason, we should consider His standards to help us determine whether a particular teacher is false or whether a particular doctrine is a false doctrine. And think of how many times the Gospels describe the confusion of the disciples, even when Jesus Himself taught. We have to have a set of measuring tools to help us test those spirits that John talked about in his first letter. John also in his Gospel, chapter 16, starting in verse 4, he tells us, "These things have I told you, that when the time shall come, you may remember that I told you of them. And these things I said not unto you at the beginning, because I was with you. But now I go my way to him that sent me. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you." And again, the main issue is, what is truth? Or maybe more rightly said, who is truth? Now, if we trust Christ's statement in those verses, it ensures us that the Holy Spirit will keep us from falling prey to false teachers or doctrines if we look to Him to do so. Do you really understand that? If you want the truth, you will get the truth. But when He brings it to you, don't try to find a way around it. Don't look for some explanation of why it can't be trusted. So I'm going to cover seven different considerations. What does this teaching, or how does this teaching impact what I think about God and what Scripture tells me about God? A vital test of any religious experience or expressed doctrine is to evaluate how it affects your relationship with God, your perception of Him, and your attitude toward Him. I don't know if you're going to take notes today, but if you really want to embrace the message today, you have to do more than just listen today. You have to take it with you. You have to meditate on it. You have to think about how it applies in your life. I'm telling you, there are seven different areas here. By the time we get to seven, you're going to forget about one or two or more. Here's the truth. God's eternal existence, His unlimited power, His sovereign authority, His perfect knowledge of all people, all creatures, and all things, and the infinite nature of all of His other attributes and character qualities make Him the perfect authority, the supreme arbiter of all things, natural and spiritual, especially truth. He created the universe and your life and my life and all life to reveal His perfections to all moral and intellectual beings. Now, not all intellectual beings are moral, but we can be in Christ. Isaiah 43:10, God testifies of Himself. You are my witnesses, saith the Lord, and my servant, whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me, and understand that I am He. Before me there was no God formed, neither shall there be after me. That speaks of His eternal quality. His attributes are infinite, and they are eternal. Nothing can be done to diminish them, to destroy them, or to modify them in any way. He is the divine arbiter, and He will be the eternal judge. In Revelation 4:11, it tells us, you know this, Thou art worthy, O God, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for Thou hast created all things, and for Thy pleasure they are and were created. You better understand, God acts without limitation and unapologetically for the sake of His glory and His reputation. He does not need you to defend Him or His ways, and He will not allow anyone to direct Him or manipulate Him for their purposes under any circumstances. That's the definition of sovereignty. In Isaiah 42, verse 8, God again declares, I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory I will not give to another, neither my praise to graven images. Second commandment, thou shalt have no graven images. That's idolatry. Behold, the former things are come to pass. I've already fulfilled everything that I said I was going to this point in time. And new things do I declare before they spring forth. I tell you of them. And He told us of these times that we would be living in a long time ago, so that as they are fulfilled, we will know that He is the only wise God. In Deuteronomy 11:16, we are warned, take heed to yourselves, that your heart be not deceived, and ye turn aside and serve other gods and worship them. And now, here's how you discern. We know the truth. Here's how you discern. Any doctrine, any teaching, any experience which serves to magnify God in our own eyes or as others perceive Him is likely to be inspired by Him. Ask yourself, has it made me love God more? Has it purified my concept of His being? Has it magnified Him in my spiritual eyes of faith? Conversely, anything which veils my view of God's glory, which makes Him appear to be less wonderful or remarkable than He is, anything that infers He is limited in any way or that He depends on me for anything, is indebted to me for anything, or is accountable to me to explain anything He has done or permitted in my life, is sure to be of the flesh, the world, or the devil. So that is rule number one. How does what you are considering or being told impact your perspective about the God of creation? Consideration number two. What does it say about Christ? Second critical test of any religious experience or doctrine is to evaluate how it affects your relationship with Christ, your perception of Him, and your attitude towards Him. We'll start out with truth. Whatever place any religion might agree to give Christ as a greater prophet or a lesser prophet, as a good, reliable teacher of spiritual truths, as a moral, saintly example to follow, or anything else, know this: God gives the preeminent place in the kingdom to Jesus. The doctrine of the Trinity, God as three co-equal persons in essence, while having superior or subordinate authority to each other, it's firmly established in scriptures, and it's confirmed in the written testimonies of the apostles and church fathers from the earliest centuries of the church age. In Philippians 2 and 1 Corinthians 15, we look at familiar passages which confirm this preeminence of Christ. Philippians 2:5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. In other words, he had every right to declare his equality with God. It would not have been considered inappropriate or stealing from God some authority that only he deserved. But made himself of no reputation voluntarily and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and he became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross, as vile and as painful and as ugly as that was. Wherefore, God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Again, God is doing all things for his glory and for the sake of his name and his reputation. In 1 Corinthians 15, 27, for he hath put all things under his feet. God has put all things under the feet of Christ. But when he saith all things are put under him, it is manifest or understood that he is accepted, or God himself is accepted, which did put all things under him, because there's still that submission of authority. Jesus is obeying what God has sent him to do. The Holy Spirit will be obeying what Christ has sent him to do. All three are God, the Trinity, in essence. But there is subordinate authority. When I was thinking about that, I was thinking about World War II, and I was thinking about the two generals who were running things in the European operation. They were both four-star generals. But Patton, who was a four-star general, was subordinate to Bradley. Yeah, Bradley. But anyway, they were both equal in rank. They were both paid exactly the same amount of money. They didn't need to salute each other. Everybody saluted them, but Patton was subordinate. That's the way it is with God, Christ, and the Holy Spirit. And when all things shall be subdued unto him, then shall the Son also be subject unto him that put all things under him, that God may be all in all. And the entire book of Hebrews is devoted to declaring Christ's supremacy as the great high priest of God in the order of Melchizedek, a priestly order far superior to that of Aaron, whose earthly priesthood was ordained by God through the tribe of Levi. So even in priestliness, there is subordinate authority. Now, here's the test. Any teacher or teaching which diminishes Christ's glory or stature, or declares Christ to not be God incarnate, Emmanuel, God with us, it's not to be trusted. God's enemy is Christ's enemy and your enemy. He has been striving to exalt himself to God's throne since the time he was known as Lucifer in Isaiah 14:12. In Christ's wilderness temptations, the devil, he's called, and also Satan in that passage in Luke 4, he desperately tried to bribe Jesus to worship him. Watch for any teacher who looks to be exalted and idolized by those who follow him or her. It is a sign that they are false and are being led by God's enemy. Look to the Holy Spirit to confirm or refute doctrines espoused by charismatic and dynamically powerful teachers. They can use those skills to deceive. Consideration number three. What does it say about the Holy Scriptures? Here's the truth. God's Word is not a book. It is God's revelation to us. And this has many critical aspects to it. God's Word is alive and speaks to us even today. The Scriptures are in print what Christ is in person. John 1:1, very familiar passage. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 14, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. In Hebrews 1:1, very eye-opening. God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who, being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. Again, repeated concepts by the power of his word for the glory of God, etc. Hebrews 4:12 continues, for the word of God is quick, which means alive, and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and it is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Now, the Word can discern the thoughts and intents of everyone's heart. But those of us whose thoughts and intents are to not be deceived can use the Word to be a discerner of the thoughts and intents of false teachers and false doctrines. Again, I don't know how well you know God's Word. This is a Bible church. You're hearing scripture after scripture after scripture, week after week after week. And I have to tell you, I measure, just like the Bereans in Acts chapter 17, when anybody is teaching, I measure what they are teaching by what the Word of God confirms or refutes. And I will not be deceived because I refuse to be deceived. God is righteous, therefore cannot lie, and his word is true. Praying to his heavenly Father for his disciples, Jesus declared in John 17:17, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Jesus confirms that God's word is God's word, and it's to be trusted. 2 Peter 1:16 and beyond, Peter declares, we have not followed cunningly devised fables. That's what false teachers can do. They can put a little truth with every lie to make it palatable to those who do not know the whole truth. When we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty, for he received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with him in the Holy Mount. And here, we have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your heart. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Scripture is inspired by God. It's dictated by the power of the Holy Spirit, and he will guide you to the truth if you trust him and you trust it. Here's the test. Any teaching which professes to elevate the authority of an alternate source to the very level of the Bible, or worse, above the authority of the Bible, is absolutely false. There is no equal to Scripture as the source of truth. There is no equal to Scripture, and there certainly is no superior to Scripture as the source of truth. The source itself is unreliable relative to the accuracy and truth of the Scripture. And that includes things like the Jewish Mishnah, the Talmud, the apocryphal books like Tobit, Judith, 1st, 2nd, 3rd, and 4th Maccabees added to some versions of the Bible, Islamic, Buddhist, Hindu, and Mormon writings, etc. Whatever originates outside the Scriptures should, for that reason, be suspect until it can be shown to be in accord with the Scriptures. And even if they can be shown to be reliable, we should ask whether there's any additional benefit or compelling argument to rely on their content to augment our biblical understanding. You may be aware that when the Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered in the caves at Qumran, starting in 1948, I believe it was, many in 1954 and up to 1959, there were other Gospels than Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. There's even a Gospel of Judas. The critics determined that there was nothing that added to the content of Scripture that would make it worthwhile to want to include those books in the Bible. So, if you're spending more time on extra-biblical resources for study, I'm not telling you not to do that, but I am telling you, don't give them equal place with the Scripture in what you end up believing, because they cannot supersede God's purpose in giving us the Scriptures. Secret knowledge, such as that of the Mormons and Masons, is nothing more than a modern version of the Gnostic heresies that John wrote about in his letters, his epistles, in the first century. And it goes against the very teachings of Jesus. Matthew 18:3, he said, "Verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven." You don't need secret knowledge. You don't need higher levels of revelation to be a child of God. God has made it so simple that all you have to do is have the faith of a child to believe in the efficacy of Christ's atoning sacrifice and his resurrection to be part of the kingdom. So, whatever increases our love for Scripture and our trust in Scripture is worth trusting as coming from God. A true lover of God will also be a lover of His Word. Consideration number four. What does it say about me? What does it say about myself? I smile because this may be the toughest teaching for all of us to accept in today's sermon. All of the other topics are not as personal as our thoughts about ourselves. I can readily testify and confess that I've sinned, maybe recently, maybe even today. But to own up to the corruption of my own sinful nature at its very core, that's a challenge. And it is this admission to my difficulty which makes false teachers' doctrines so attractive. We have to own the fact that we are not worthy to be saved. And so much in today's popular teachings focus more on self than on God. We're told that God wants us to be happy, healthy, and wealthy. Today, sin is considered hate speech, and it's supposedly focused on damaging self-esteem to establish unhealthy religious control through brainwashing of weak individuals. Much that is being promoted and experienced in Christ's name today is false to Christ, in that it is conceived by the flesh, incorporates fleshly methods, and seeks fleshly ends. Here's the truth. No one is good except God and those who receive Christ's righteousness vicariously through his sacrifice on the cross. 2 Corinthians 5:21 tells us, "For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." Truth will always confront fallen man. It will convict him of sin and sinfulness and reveal that his only hope is in Christ's redemption and resurrection to new life. All of your good works don't mount up to much in comparison to Christ's perfect work. Luke 18:18 tells us, "A certain ruler asked him," Jesus, "saying, Good master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said unto him, Why callest thou me good? None is good save one, that is God." Now, is Jesus claiming there that he's not God? No. What Jesus is saying, if you call me good, are you recognizing that I am God in the flesh, Emmanuel with us? Why do you call me good? And each one of us has to be asked that same question. Is Jesus God? Romans 3:10 to 12 tells us, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. We don't really have the capacity to do good until God seeks us out by the power of the Holy Spirit, opens our mind to the truth, and converts us into new creatures who then have the power of Christ living in them to do His good works. That is Ephesians 2, verse 10. We often stop at verse 9, starting with verse 8. For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith, and this not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. That's 8 and 9. 10. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works that God prepared in advance that we should walk in them. The Holy Spirit demands our complete consent to replace our natural self with the person of Christ. And how many times have we quoted this passage in Galatians 5:17? The flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. You would like to do things in a more perfect way, but you are unable unless the Spirit of God is doing them in you and through you. Much of what takes place in post-Christian and post-modern fellowships consists of pseudo-religious experiences. They provide carnal enjoyment, which feeds the flesh and puffs up the heart with self-love. Feel-good stuff. These often orchestrated manifestations of the Spirit expose the weak faith of those who look to them to encourage them to walk by sight and not by faith. Here's the test. If a teaching or experience serves to humble me in my own eyes, it is likely from God. Not to shame, to humble. If it gives me a sense of self-satisfaction, it is likely false and should be denied. Point number 5, what does it say about the world? If we accept Christ's call in Matthew 28, the Great Commission, we will rightly carry a sense that we must do everything we can to reach a lost world with the gospel. However, this burden can result in a watering down of the gospel to make it more attractive. Such changes can reduce Jesus to a whimpering, suffering Savior who would do anything to get someone to say the sinner's prayer. Some feel that we need to show the world that following Jesus is fun and easy, requiring no real changes in life. But here's the truth. We do not save the world. We do not save anyone. Jesus does. And strongly standing against and resisting the world's ways and its attractions, even to the point of suffering, persecution, or death, that's the best way to demonstrate the sincerity of our faith, our commitment to its truth, and the ultimate cost to be paid for it. Anyone looking for a cause worthy of their life's investment will be drawn to such faith. It worked that way in the first century church. John, in 1 John 2, 15 to 17, tells us, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. James warns us in chapter 4, verse 4, know ye not that friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Any teaching which encourages compromise with worldly values as a way to attract the lost to Jesus is misleading at best and utterly deceiving in actuality. We are to be the salt and the light to a lost world and should resist any worldly teaching or doctrine that could make us more like that world. The truth is, Jesus watched people walk away. He let people walk away who found his demands too difficult to accept. As his representatives, we need to take that to heart. Again, that certain ruler in Luke 18, 18, saying, good master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus responded in verse 22, lackest thou one thing? Sell all that thou hast and distribute unto the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me. And when he heard this, he was very sorrowful, for he was very rich. And when Jesus saw that he was very sorrowful, he said, how hardly shall they that have riches enter into the kingdom of God? There are those who want salvation, but do not want the Savior. Any teaching that convinces you that you can have the world and Jesus both is false and is hazardous to your eternal soul. Consideration number 6. What does it say about sin? Truth. Sin's presence in the world and in your life is merely symptomatic of a deeper problem. Man's sinful nature resulting from Adam's choice in the garden. Do you know that even if you were never to sin, your sin nature is death incarnate? That is why a man must be born again. The sin nature itself is sentenced to death and is wicked enough to result in eternal judgment and subjection to God's wrath. Without God's mercy and Christ's sacrifice, there is no hope that anyone will be able to stand before God in the judgment. Jeremiah 44, beginning in verse 2. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, ye have seen all the evil that I have brought upon Jerusalem and upon all the cities of Judah, and behold, this day they are a desolation, and no man dwelleth therein. God confesses to bringing evil judgment upon a nation that does not follow him. I don't know what you think about hurricanes or tornadoes or earthquakes or plagues or any of those things. We can maybe view scientific rules and laws that might explain them, but that doesn't mean that God is not bringing them against a nation that has rejected him. We're not entitled to his goodness and grace if we don't honor him in his sovereignty. And if bringing these judgments upon Israel brought them back to him, God can absolutely be justified in bringing judgment on the world to draw people to him in their misery and their response to trials and tribulations. That goes back to what I said. He doesn't have to answer to anybody. He doesn't have to explain himself to anybody, and we don't have to defend him. He's got broad shoulders. He told Moses in Exodus chapter 4, when Moses was complaining that he didn't have good speech, God said, "Who gave man his tongue? Who makes him deaf or dumb or blind? I do. I love a God who is confident in his righteousness, his sovereignty, and his wisdom in bringing about his ends through whatever ways he determines are the best way to accomplish them." Verse 3 in Jeremiah 44, "Because of their wickedness which they have committed to provoke me to anger, in that they went to burn incense and to serve other gods, whom they knew not, neither they, ye, nor your fathers. Howbeit, I sent unto you all my servants the prophets, rising early and sending them, saying, Oh, do not this abominable thing that I hate. But they hearken not, nor incline their ear to turn from their wickedness, to burn no incense unto other gods." Do you know how many strange gods have been brought into our nation through the foreigners that have come from Eastern cultures? They didn't come to become Christian. They didn't come to become Americans. They came to draw from this land all the good that they could and hold on to their idolatrous practices. And they have influenced our children, our families, our friends, and some of us to embrace their practices. And we have no business burning incense to other gods. Whatever makes holiness more attractive and desirable, and sin more repulsive and intolerable, can be trusted to be from God. Do not fall for such lies as, "There are good witches and there are bad witches. There are white lies and black lies. Everything is relative, and the ends justify the means." Any teacher or doctrine which accepts or promotes compromise with pride, greed, or lust, and all of their related sins should be rejected as a tool of the enemy to lure you away from God and destroy the testimony of your changed life. Additionally, any teaching which suggests or promises that there are sins so minor that penance of any sort will eliminate their punishment, that's false. Trusting in such teachings will condemn you to hell. Consideration number 7. What does it say about salvation? Any teacher or teaching which promises eternal life without our humbly submitting to Christ's atoning sacrifice is utterly false, and the deception comes from the pit of hell itself. Here, it is important to say that even God-ordained teachers can err. That's why you got to be a Berean. That's why you have to compare what's being taught with the Scripture. That's why when we teach, we give you the Scriptures that support the teaching. A lot of pastors these days teach on subject matter, things that are relevant culturally, things that are relevant personally, work, whatever. We can err in doctrine if we're not applying these own measurements to our studies, our understandings and interpretations. And I have to tell you, I think I've said this before from the pulpit, what I believe today in 2024 has grown and expanded from what I believed in April of 1980 when I first received the Lord. Over 44 years, I've learned a lot of things. A lot has been revealed to me because I've done the work. And so whatever sermon I could have preached in 1980 would be substantially different than what I'm teaching today and could have been subject to more error because of my lack of seniority in studying God's Word. So just because somebody stands up and teaches does not mean that they cannot unintentionally introduce an error. Test us. Paul, he congratulated the Bereans because they were more noble than the Thessalonians in that every day at the end of his teaching, they went to the scriptures to prove if what he said was true. Here's truth. Scripture is clear. Jesus is clear. Neither are confused or in any way compromising in declaring the way of salvation. I don't even have to quote John 3:16 or John 14:6. Let's go straight to John 3:36. He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. John 5:10. He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. That's the Holy Spirit. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. And this is the record, that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. And Acts 4:8, the last verse for today. 4:8 to 12. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, like I said throughout this message, he is charged with keeping you from errors. Filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, ye rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, this was the response to their questioning him about when he and John gave the lame man the ability to walk, where he said, I don't have silver or I don't have gold, but what I have I'm going to give to you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. So if we this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known unto you and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. Wow, what boldness, what courage, what confidence in the truth of Christ's resurrection and the power of the Holy Spirit. Every one of us should be able to leave this place today with the same confidence and courage to declare the truth to people. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Remember, a lie is a lie, even if everyone believes it. The truth is the truth, even if no one believes it. Sin is a sin, even if everybody's doing it. And righteousness is righteousness, even if nobody is following it. So if you honestly and faithfully apply these seven tests to any teacher or doctrine you are considering following, I'm convinced that the Holy Spirit will give you godly discernment in deciding between that which is true and that which is false. Let's pray. Lord, you prayed that God would sanctify us by his truth. The sanctification is seen in the setting us apart, in the establishing your righteousness within us, making us saintly. And you yourself claim, Jesus, that your Father's word is the truth. I pray today, Lord, that each one of us would embrace that so seriously in our spirits that we would be driven to set time to study your word, to know it, to meditate on it, to memorize it, to apply it in our lives. And Lord, that as social gospel and politically correct things are thrust in front of us, Father, we acknowledge that things like that can be very attractive. They seem loving to be willing to embrace anybody wherever they happen to be in life. And you do call us to love selflessly. You call us to love even those who are enemies of ours. But you do not call us to compromise. And we have to tell the truth that they cannot have the world and you both. So we submit ourselves to you today, Lord. We thank you for this message. And we pray that you use it for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Larry. Oh, man. Father, we just want to thank you again for this opportunity and for our pastor, Larry, who is so passionate about sharing the truth with us, Lord God, and the seriousness of the call and the seriousness of the charge to us, Lord God, to discern your truth from the ways of the world. And Father, we just want to thank you for being the one that goes before us, Lord God, the one that stands for us, that your armies will protect us, Lord God. And we just pray that as we walk out these doors today, that we don't lose sight of who you are and that your spirit is in us and that we are called to proclaim you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right.
Just a few announcements and we'll be on our way. I want to welcome you to Ascent Bible Church. Thank you for joining us to worship the Lord Jesus today. If this was your first time here, you should have received a bag with several things in it. Among them are two cards, one blue and one pink. The blue one is for you to record your contact information if you would like us to follow up and get to know you, let you get to know us. The pink is for prayer requests if you have anything you'd like us to pray for. Prayer cards and visitor cards are to be dropped in the box, the offering box, hanging on the sound booth at the center of the rear of the sanctuary. Also, inside there is a heaven card which you can use to guide you to your own salvation or to share with someone you care about who does not yet know the Lord Jesus as Savior. Anyone can get extra cards there in the lobby, and also you can stop by the table on your way out the door if there's not enough in the lobby to handle your need. Listen, we are not meeting on Wednesday this week. If you show up on Wednesday, the door will be locked. We are meeting Tuesday evening at 6:30. The speaker we have, Bruce Finger, was not available on Wednesday. So we scheduled him for Tuesday at 6:30. He'll be teaching on personal awareness, situational awareness, how you spot people who might be approaching you in parking lots and what to do about that. He's going to be covering basic personal protection, self-defense stuff. So I highly suggest you come for that. You will benefit from the teaching. When we started the service, I mentioned that we are not living in a playground. We are living in a battleground. That doesn't mean we have to be terrified. It just means we have to be trained and ready. So come on Tuesday to better prepare yourself for those unexpected things that could be challenging to you. Pals, ladies, you are meeting this coming Saturday. Larry Romero will not be back. Janine Herrera will be leading it. So please come 9:30 and be ready for a devotional and time to pray together and to minister to each other. Remember next Saturday night to turn your clocks back. If you do not do that, you will be here for prayer at 9 o'clock. And that's okay. But anyway, I like this little guy. Doesn't he just capture that satisfaction? Turn your clocks back next Saturday. Okay. The best is yet to come. And it's got to be better than what you heard this week and last week. So that's Pastor Mike's topic for next Sunday. Let's be here to support him and hear the great wisdom that God's given him. There's going to be a memorial service for Karen Scoob here on Saturday the 9th. That's 2 weeks from yesterday. It will be followed by a potluck to bless the family, because there's going to be quite a few family members here. There is a sign-up sheet on the tables to the right before you go out the door. Please, this week and next week, we will be signing up to bring things for the potluck and plan to attend that. Operation Christmas Child is in full swing. There are still boxes available. Roberta, are you there for Operation Christmas Child? Okay, she's just standing up. Because really, it's Florence and Mariah Salazar. You can pick up a box by the table. There's also a flyer that tells you how to fill the box, how to pack the box, et cetera, et cetera. So if you pick up a box or two or three, make sure you get the flyer as well. Last year on Thanksgiving Day, we hosted a Thanksgiving afternoon lunch/dinner. It was fantastic. Any of you ladies who would like to escape the terror of cooking Thanksgiving dinner and the burden that that brings on you, plan to bring your family here. We will be having sign-ups in the next couple weeks. I'm sure the church will provide the turkeys and hams, and we'll look to families to provide the yams and sauce and gravy and all of that jazz. So, but plan on it. We're giving you enough time to plan. I think we had 70 or 80 people last year. It was amazing. It was a great time of fellowship. We sang some songs together. We ate together. The food was fantastic. You don't have to get beaten up on Thanksgiving Day by getting up at 5 in the morning to stuff the bird. Okay. And finally, thanks to Kathy and her team, coffee and cookies in the fellowship room right after service. If you want to pray in person, meet us in the prayer room. Next. There you go. Meet us in the prayer room if you want to pray in person, or fill out one of the yellow pink cards and drop them in the offering box. We'll pray for you this week. And also the pantry is open, and we will be having a needs sheet coming up to restock the pantry because people are hitting it hard. We're spending between $500 and $600 a month on pantry food. So this is ministry to our people and to the people outside that we want to reach with the love of Christ. So just be aware. This is a vital ministry that God is using in our church to touch hearts. God bless you all. Thank you for your attendance and your attention. Have a tremendous week. Remember, Thursday night is Halloween. We should be praying with all that we have for protection for God's children and for His Spirit to come upon the devil's children, to bring them into our family. Amen. God bless you. Yeah. One more thing.
Saturday is neighborhood walk.
Oh, that's right. How did I miss that? Saturday being the first Saturday in November will be neighborhood walks. I will be sending out an e-blast on Thursday with instructions and a reminder for you. Okay? Have a great week.